Welcome back, dear students. So in the last class we had a discussion about cloudburst. If you can remember, we defined cloudburst as excessive rainfall in a very short period of time. In continuation with that, today we will be discussing the disaster and its management, and today's disaster is regarding the droughts. So let us start with today's lecture. So what are the things that we will be covering in today's lecture? A little introduction, classification, occurrence of droughts in the world with Indian scenario, historical data with regards to India. Now causes, we will be discussing impacts, we will be discussing about various indicators, we will be discussing about relief measures, then institutional response system, mitigation of droughts, and finally we'll be concluding today's class. Now how do we define it? A temporary reduction in water or moisture availability significantly below the normal or expected level for a specific period. Okay, so it is a temporary reduction. Whenever a big high weightage, high marks weightage question comes in your paper, you should be using different types of definitions like here. Also, you should be using the specific definition as per geography, as per disaster management concepts. Okay. Next, a period of dry weather of sufficient length and severity to cause at least partial crop failure. So either there should be a significantly low amount of moisture level for a specific period, or there should be at least partial crop failure, or actual moisture supply at a given place consistently falls short of the climatically expected moisture supply. Okay, either there is a shortage in expected moisture content, or there is a partial crop failure, or third one, that there is a low amount of moisture for a specific period. So all these various simple definitions help us in understanding that how do we define a drought. Next we have, as per NIDM, that is National Institute of Disaster Management, now it is a temporary aberration in aridity which is permanent feature of climate. This is the definition given by NIDM. Okay. Next we have a definition given by National Drought Mitigation Center, USA. They define it as, it is often referred to as creeping phenomena and its impact vary from region to region. Okay. These are some points from the Apex Research Institutes with regards to droughts. Next, we have classification. What are the different types of droughts? So mainly meteorological droughts, hydrological droughts, and agricultural droughts. Let us define them quickly. We define meteorological droughts as significant decrease from normal precipitation over an area. Precipitation, or we can also say it as significant decrease from normal rainfall over an area. Hydrological droughts, it is defined as depletion of surface water and fall in water tables. Surface water, we mean, what do we understand by surface waters? For example, lakes, rivers, ponds, etc. Okay, these are surface waters. Then water table, it is with respect to ground water table, that what is the level of ground water. So what are some of the methods of extraction? They are tube well, hand pump, etc. Okay, so I'm also defining parallelly. So for the students, who are not aware about these terms, they will be getting familiar. Most of the civil engineering students are familiar with these terms because we study it in various subjects. Next, we have agricultural droughts. So soil moisture and rainfall happens to be inadequate to support the crops. This is another type of drought. Okay. I hope you all will remember these basic three classifications and their meanings. Next, amongst meteorological droughts, there is moderate droughts or severe droughts. Now, if the rainfall deficiency is over 20% of area, okay, rainfall deficiency of over 20% of area is between 26% and 50%, then it is a moderate drought. What are severe droughts? If the rainfall deficiency over 20% of area is greater than 50%. To explain it, I'll take an example of an open area of a specified area with defined limits. Let us say this entire region is having an area of, let us say, 100 square kilometers. Okay, let us say that in a particular time period, due to some conditions, about 20% of area, the 20% can be distributed or it can be together. So all this combines to be 20% of total area. This one, if it is less than, the rainfall is less than 26 to 50%, okay, for example, every year there used to be a rainfall of 100 millimeters here. Now there is a deficiency, and let us say the rainfall is between 50 to 74%. So we will consider it as moderate drought. And in case of severe drought, if the rainfall is even less than 50 mm, for these particular areas, particular 20% of areas, the rainfall is even less than 50 mm, then we define it as severe drought. Okay. Then we have classifications of area affected. So drought prone areas and chronic drought prone areas. How do we define it? Those areas that experience meteorological drought in 20% of years, and those area that experience meteorological drought greater than 40% of year, that it implies about the time duration in a particular year. Okay, if the area is experiencing these types of droughts for 20% of the year, then we define those areas as drought prone areas. And if the drought conditions are more than 40% of the time of an year, then we define it as chronic drought prone areas. Okay. Now this is a global map showing the pattern of intensity of drought globally. Okay. This is for global frequency for between 2000 and 2008. Here it is mentioned drought events. I don't know if it is visible to you, so I'm writing it here also. Drought events. So as you can see, yellow color marks 1 to 2 drought events in these 8 years. Red areas, red portions describe that there are about 3 drought events. And these specifically dark red areas or maroon areas, they depict that more than 3 drought events have occurred. So India and China region comes under into this drought occurrence of more than 3 events for the time period of 2000 to 2008. Here again we have classified the global map in terms of drought, extreme drought and historic drought. So extreme drought regions are these: Eastern African region, देन द सेंट्रल पार्ट ऑफ साउथ अमेरिका एंड दीज पर्टिकुलर रीजन दे कम अंडर द ड्रॉट एंड द रेड एरियाज कम अंडर हिस्टोरिक ड्रॉट. ओके, वी जस्ट नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड द बेसिक्स दैट वेयर द प्रॉब्लम्स ऑफ ड्रॉट आर हाई. नाउ ड्रॉट एंड इंडियन सिनेरियो, सो रेनफॉल डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन लेट अस सी. इन द मंथ बिटवीन मार्च टू मे वी सी अराउंड 10% ऑफ रेनफॉल अकरिंग. देन इन जून टू सेप्टेम्बर विच इज आर मॉनसून पीरियड अबाउट रफली अबाउट 75% ऑफ रेनफॉल अकर्स ड्यूरिंग दीज 3 months. देन फर्दर देर आर डिफरेंट स्पेसिफिक टाइम पीरियड्स ऑफ अ ईयर वेयर डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ रेनफॉल अकर्स. सो द कंट्री कंट्रीज वल्नरेबिलिटी इज डिस्क्राइब्ड हियर. द 33% ऑफ एरिया रिसीव्स रेनफॉल विच इज लेस देन 750 mm. वी से इट टू बी क्रॉनिकली ड्रॉट प्रोन एरिया 33% ऑफ द एरिया. ओके, देन 35% एरिया रिसीव रेनफॉल बिटवीन 750 to 1125 mm. दिस इज अंडर ड्रॉट प्रोन एरिया एंड अराउंड टोटल 68% ऑफ द एरिया कम्स आउट टू बी प्रोन टू ड्रॉट. नाउ दीज स्पेसिफिक नंबर्स माइट नॉट बी आस्क्ड इन योर पेपर्स बट यू नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट अराउंड 1/3 ऑफ द कंट्री कम्स अंडर क्रॉनिकली ड्रॉट प्रोन एरियाज. अनदर 1/3 ऑफ द कंट्री इज कमिंग अंडर ड्रॉट प्रोन एरियाज and the rainfall amount for consideration is 750 mm. If the rainfall is less than 750 mm, then we define it as chronically drought prone area, and if it is between 750 to 1125 mm, then it is in drought prone area. Now this is the drought map according to IMD. IMD stands for Indian Meteorological Department. Okay, let us have a look here. So this dashed area is for chronically drought prone area. So areas of Rajasthan, Gujarat, they come under chronically drought prone areas, and frequently drought prone areas, these areas starting from Jammu and Kashmir till Karnataka, Telangana, etc., except this Uttarakhand area. Then least drought prone areas are these green one, northeast area, then eastern states, and then western ghat areas. Okay, they come under least drought prone areas. Now this is the pattern of drought occurrence for the year 2012 by IMD. So as you can see, the parts of Rajasthan and parts of Gujarat, they happen to come under severe droughts. Then this pink color shows moderate droughts. Light green shows mild. And these green areas, they are non-drought areas. Okay. So these are some of the most vulnerable and chronically drought prone areas. We need to keep it in mind. Okay, now these are some historical data, you might go through it. In terms of disaster management, have a look at these numbers, that how many people are affected in each drought and how should a system be developed or managed to cater the needs of roughly around 100 million people in each drought. Okay, this is a huge challenge. Now what are some of the causes of the droughts? Some of the natural causes are prevalence of high air pressure system over particular geographical area, then high level of sunlight, that is a longer duration of sunlight causing the drying of water vapor present in atmosphere. Then third point, we have wind carrying continental air mass rather than oceanic air mass. equaling to continental air mass, which is drier than oceanic air mass, which triggers the rainfall seldom. Then fourth point is the absence of obstruction in the way of water vapor carrying clouds, which in this case, presence of obstruction can facilitate cooling of water vapor. For this, I will take one example to explain all of you. I'm drawing a typical map of India, Indian subcontinent entirely. So this is somewhat the map of Indian region, okay? Now we all know that monsoon, India, in terms of Indian subcontinent, the major rainfall is due to monsoon. And the most important monsoon is this southwest monsoon, in which from this Arabian Sea, the water vapors, they are flown away by the winds and they cover the majority of the part of India and the rainfall occurs at all the various states. Does anyone know that why these winds, they just don't, why they don't pass on to our neighboring countries such as China? These winds can even blow right across India and they might go and flow towards Chinese region, but this is not the case. The reason for this is the presence of Himalayas. Due to this very huge mountainous belt that is Himalaya, what happens that all these wind that are carrying the moisture, they get stopped there, or they find obstructions, and due to this obstruction, it leads to rising of this air, this particular wind, cooling into water vapor and hence condensing, that is rainfall. So these particular regions happen to get a lot of rainfall because of this effect. If we take a different section, let us see. Let us consider this as the Himalaya. I am taking this section. Okay, I am viewing from this side. Let us say these winds are coming, they are carrying moisture. If this Himalaya is not there, it will be directly crossing. Okay, they will be carrying the moisture and no rainfall will be occurred. But due to presence of the Himalaya, what happens? That these winds, first of all, they get, they collide with it. The Himalayas act as obstruction, and because of it, these winds, they rise up. And they rise up, as they rise up in the atmosphere, they cool down, and this cooling of water vapor results into rainfall. So this is the phenomena that we are talking about in these points. Next, some more natural causes we have: absence of humidity, which helps to condense the water vapor. For example, in Gujarat and Rajasthan area, there is a very low amount of humidity, and because of which we don't observe much of rain. Then erratic distribution of monsoon. During some of the years, we see that the rainfall is not same or the rainfall is not equal in the entirety of geographical area, entire geographical area. There is a varied amount of rainfall in different years and different parts of month and different areas. So it leads to inconsistent amount of rainfall, leading to sometimes it is lack of moisture, and sometimes it becomes excess, leading to floods. So these varying conditions lead to this erratic distribution of monsoon. Then seventh point says that disruption in the pattern of trade winds and oceanic currents. These are some geographical terms. As of now, we don't need much to go inside it because it in itself is a very huge topic, the concept of trade winds and oceanic currents. For now, I will say that these disruptions in trade wind directions and oceanic currents, they lead to the conditions in which less rainfall occur and eventually droughts occur. Then the next point is occurrence of El Nino. Now this is also a geographical concept. Let me just describe you it in a very, very basic language. See what happens. I just mentioned that the Indian subcontinent, this is the Indian subcontinent. Okay. Here is our Sri Lanka. So what India observes is southwestern monsoon. These are the winds carrying moisture in it. Now, where do these winds come from? Or the rainfall which occurs from the side of Bay of Bengal, where do these winds come from? These winds come due to the change of pressure. In this Tibetan region, there is a low pressure zone due to excessive heat during the summer, and here it is a high pressure zone. As we know, winds travel from high pressure to low pressure and eventually they carry the moisture along with them. Okay, but where do these high pressure winds come from and how do they carry the moisture? These concepts are related to oceanic currents again. The cycle revolves even around the western coast of South America, the region of Peru and all. So from here, the prevailing conditions here also affect the movement of these winds and these oceanic currents through the region of Indonesia, Philippines, and eventually to India. Okay. I will not be able to go much into detail about El Nino, although I will be sharing some conceptual videos which will be describing El Nino in much detail. I can also describe the same, but it will be taking another good amount of time and it's not much of focus right now. Our main focus right now is to understand the disaster management concepts with regards to droughts. These are some of the natural causes. If anyone is interested to learn these geographical concepts, then I'll share a video. Please watch it. Next, we come to man-made reasons or human activities. So some of them are global warming, deforestation, excessive irrigation over a particular area, then soil erosion, absence of rainwater harvesting system. You might be knowing or you might have heard in the news recently that Rajasthan government is also working tremendously in the field of rainwater harvesting system so that all the residential and office areas, they develop a rainwater harvesting system so that whenever the rains come during the monsoons, we are able to collect it in some particular tanks so that we can reuse it in the times when it is required the most, or when the drought occurs, we can use that particular water. Next, what are some of the impacts of droughts? The direct impact, they include reduced agricultural production, depleted water level, then higher mortality rate for humans and wildlife. What is mortality rate? The rate at which people die, okay, or the death occurring in a particular time period. So in case of droughts, the rate of mortality increases for both humans as well as wildlife. Then there is damage to livestock. What is livestock? The animals that are animals such as cow, buffaloes, sheep, goats that are fed, that are kept by humans for their business purposes as well as taking milk and all, and for their livelihood. Next, we have indirect impacts. They include reduced income for the farmers. then increased unemployment, increased rate of inflation, and decreased purchase capacity of common man. So you can feel, you can understand that what are the major impacts of droughts and how disastrous it is for a particular nation, particular state, how difficult it is to manage. So it is best that we try to prevent it, we try to develop as much as rainwater harvesting and other systems of preservation of water. We waste the least amount of water possible. Next, let us have a look about the economic impacts. These include reduced GDP, reduced purchase power parity, reduced exports, reduced forex reserves, decreased value of currency, increased inflation. Then environmental impacts include reduced groundwater level, forest cover gets reduced, disruption in ecosystem, loss of biodiversity. Then we have social impacts, migration of rural population. They tend to migrate from that particular area because of drought. Disruption in socio-economic conditions of families, malnutrition due to starvation. Now, various indicators for assessment of drought. Now, these are meteorological indicators such as rainfall data, okay, monthly aggregated data of precipitation, that is of rain and snow, are compared with average values from long-term observations, maybe from 100 years, 50 years. We take data and we compare it with those data for that particular year, and we find that whether the rainfall is less or more, if it is less, then by how much. Then there is one SPI, Standardized Precipitation Index. This SPI calculation, it is done with monthly precipitation, which is fitted to a two parameter gamma probability distribution function. We don't need to go again in much into it. We just need to understand there is two meteorological drought indicators. One is rainfall data, another one is Standardized Precipitation Index. Next, some more, we have CPA, that is Cumulative Precipitation Anomaly. Then we have Effective Drought Index or EDI. Then we have Rainfall Anomaly Index or RAI. So again, these are developed by different agencies, different scientists, different people, and they are used accordingly for various conditions. Next, we have soil moisture drought indicators, that how based upon the soil moisture content the drought is evaluated. First, we have Palmer Drought Severity Index, PDSI, developed by Palmer in 1965. To provide an index based on drought severity that allowed the comparison of droughts with different time and spatial scales, that is for different regions and different times. They take into account precipitation, evapotranspiration, soil moisture content. Okay, then we have Palmer Z index. It is used for calculation of soil moisture droughts. Okay, the Z index is derived from calculation of this PDSI. Next, what we have further some more indicators such as soil moisture deficit index, then crop moisture index, and etc. others. Then we have third one, that is hydrological drought indicators. So they include surface water supply index, SWSI. It was developed to deal with accumulation of snow and the delayed runoff caused by this process. It is suitable for the calculation of hydrological droughts, and it incorporates climatologic and hydrological characteristics into a single index value. Then we have groundwater resource index, we have base flow index. So all these terms the students from civil engineering background will be much more familiar with the concept they have learned in hydrology. I hope you can recall the subject of hydrology. These all terms were introduced in various different topics, such as base flow, groundwater resource, then surface water supplies. We don't need to again go in much detail, but we just need to at least remember the way some of the names of these indexes so that we can use it for our answers, so that if in case it is required to apply the concepts of disaster management, you should be aware that there are some indexes which you can use to evaluate the drought conditions. Then we have drought relief. So multi-sectoral and multi-dimensional relief and response systems. Now they include, the relief measures include contingency crop planning, suggestion of cropping to farmers region wise, advocate of crop diversity, provision of agro advisory agency. So let us understand some of these terms. First of all is dissemination of information to farmers. So the farmers need to be made aware that a particular year, based upon scientific studies and satellite data, or if there is a case of drought running, then farmers need to be made aware that don't grow crops which are water intensive. Grow crops which require less amount of water, so that they don't indulge in damages and all. Next, suggestion of cropping to farmers region wise. So for particular region and for particular season, the farmers should change their cropping pattern. Okay, for example, for monsoons they can go for water intensive crops, and for the summers, winters, they can go for different crops. Then advocating crop diversity, that is, what do you understand by crop diversity? Let us consider that it to be an agricultural field. Okay, so it is advised not to grow a same crop. Let us say a particular farmer just grows crop A. This will be not advisable. It is advisable that you grow multiple crops in same field. It will not only enhance the soil quality but also help in drought relief measures. Next, what are the support that can be provided to farmers? That is agricultural input support, that government procures all these agricultural products. Then we can provide energy support, that is electricity support, water support, etc. Extension support, tax-free credits to farmers, that is tax-free loans, incentives for production of allied products such as animal husbandry and milk production, etc. So we can incentivize farmers. Nowadays, from past 2-3 around 4-5 years, a new concept has also came up in the Indian context, that is crop insurance. So farmers can get their crops insured, that in case of drought, the financial burden will be on insurance agency and they will be getting the monetary benefit from it at least. Next, there are some relief employment. So NREGA scheme may be employed. For example, there is a severe drought and people are not getting any jobs, so NREGA might be employed there. Then this MP-led and MLA-led funds may be used. These are local area development program funds given by the government to all the MPs and MLAs. So they can use that particular fund for giving relief measures. Then relief employment by the district disaster management committee can be given. Next, we have some points regarding water resource management. Okay, now provision of water for basic need of human, for basic need of cattle, so it must be provided. Reservoirs may be developed so that the extra water that is being collected during the rainfall season can be used during the non-rainfall or dry seasons. Okay, then special measures for drinking water may be provided, construction of temporary water pipelines in case of droughts, mobilization of water from local reservoir with the help of local transport systems such as bullock carts, etc. You might have also heard during some years there comes conditions when the government has to even use trains and trucks to provide water to drought hit areas. I hope you all might have heard about it or learned about it from news at some point on your age, that due to a drought in particular specific areas of Rajasthan, the government has deployed trains that will be fetching water from some rivers, and they will be sharing that water with that drought prone area. Next, some other measures include food security measures, that is to provide food to all the people there, providing nutritional food, providing midday meal programs, cattle camps, maybe fodder supply, then transferring equivalent cash to the beneficiary to help buying the grains with the help of direct benefit transfer scheme, then low cost grain supply with the help of PDS, that is ration and all. Then we have gratuitous assistance, so tax waivers and concessions may be given to the people there, then reduction of interest rate for affected people. Okay, these are some of the relief measures that the management can give, the government can give to the people who are being affected because of this drought. Next, let us have a look about the institutional response to droughts, how the governments tackle this particular problem, what are the various agencies. So first we have central government. So Ministry of Agriculture, it is responsible. Then Drought Management Division is there. Then we have CRF, that is Calamity Relief Fund. We have National Calamity Contingency Fund. Right now, due to this pandemic of COVID, you must have heard that our Prime Minister started a different fund also, Prime Minister CARES Fund, and with the help of which currently many oxygen concentrators and oxygen demand is being fulfilled using that same fund. Then IMD and NIDM, they coordinate for technical input, that scientific studies and technical data can be collected from and worked by NIDM and IMD. Then at the central level, we have National Crisis Management Committee, which holds decision over policy decisions. Okay, then we have state governments. So Department of Disaster Management, it is responsible for state government decisions. Then we have Relief Commissioner, who issues directions and instructions. Then we have district administration coordinating with gram panchayats and NGO to reach the grassroots levels. Okay, then what are some of the mitigation measures of droughts? So mitigation, what it means? It means the action taken before or at the onset of disaster to reduce the adverse impacts of the same. So we have National Rainfed Area Authority, NRAA. It was set up to look drought mitigation in long term basis. Then we have Watershed Development in India. So what it is? It is integrated watershed management program, that is low cost and using locally available technology for water conservation, soil moisture conservation, biomass production, increasing the land productivity and pasture development. Next, we have drought prone areas programs and desert development program. It means to drought proofing and combating desert in arid and semi-arid areas. Then we have implementation of these mitigation measures. So, for example, water harvesting and conservation. What are some of the things that can be done for this? Artificial recharge of groundwater through these methods: contour bunding, contour trenching, contour cultivation. Then we have bench tracing, graded bunding, gully plugging. We can construct check dams. We can construct gabion structures. Then what are some of the traditional methods? For the rural areas, there are dug well recharge systems. There are tankas, kundis, bavdi, khadins. Then we have spring water harvesting system. For the urban areas, for cities, we may develop rooftop drainage systems and paved, unpaved area drains from the roads and open areas. So we can collect all this water and put it in some sort of reservoir so that it might be used at a later stage as and when required. Next, we have some of other mitigation measures which include innovative irrigation methodology such as drip and sprinkler irrigation system. Then we can take some measures for prevention of and evaporation losses of the reservoir. Reservoir basically dams. So how can we preserve the evaporation loss? You might not be knowing that around 15 to 20% of the waters it gets lost from the dams and reservoirs just because of evaporation. Then we can go for afforestation, we can go for crop insurance schemes, we can go for community participation in drought mitigation. Okay. Now let us conclude today's session on drought. So drought, first of all, is a creeping phenomenon which imposes adverse impact on each nook and corner of the social economic fabric of the society. India has large arid and semi-arid areas which comes under drought. Third, we have researchers have developed various indicators to assess the impacts of drought, so we should use them. Next, in India, we have established institutional framework to combat the drought. It should be given more funds. An institutional framework consists of central and federal structure of the organizations. That is National Disaster Response Center. However, a struggle was faced while implementing the mitigation measures. So all these problems should be addressed by the government. A need was felt to motivate research into policy formulation as well as technical aspects to strengthen the capacity building to combat natural calamity like droughts. Even with our course on disaster management, why it has been brought and included with all the branches of engineering is because the government is trying to bring in the intelligent minds of all you developing budding engineers so that you can come up with ideas, you can come up with concepts which will be helpful in preparing ourselves, our nation, against the various disasters. So that is the reason the disaster management course is being taught to everyone, and it plays a very important role then when the youth and the technical youth engineers, they come up with some brilliant ideas. So it definitely makes a difference in the society. So that's all for this lecture on droughts. I hope you learned quite a new things, you revised quite few concepts, and I hope that you will be watching the lecture series continuously. So that's all for today's lecture. Have a good day and see you in the next one.